Welcome. Thank you all for joining us tonight. We're excited to be here for this webinar.
I'm pretty excited. So a little bit about me. I am an educator, writer, and I'm the founder of a company called Kairos, Chronic Pain Coaching. But perhaps more importantly, I have been a chronic pain and chronic illness sufferer for the past 12 years. So for those of you who don't know my story, I was diagnosed with a rare form of a common women's reproductive disease named deep infiltrating endometriosis when I was just 28 years old. And so as most of you unfortunately know, when you're diagnosed with chronic pain or chronic illness, you sort of go through this process. And I was struggling mentally, emotionally, and of course physically. And I was shocked at how much my life has changed, like in every single aspect I could imagine. Everything that I thought I knew, I no longer knew. And then in 2011, I tragically lost my father, my best friend, to glioblastoma brain cancer. And by 2013, after 8 years of marriage, it too fell apart. And so did I. So I always say that pain in all its forms is my wheelhouse, which is exactly why I decided to go back to school and establish this company to basically just help others develop the coping skills needed, you know, to fight the difficult battle of chronic pain and chronic illness. So before we actually begin, I know you guys have already done 13 minutes of waiting. I just need to say that it is really important that you understand that I am not a physician. Therefore, anything presented in this webinar should not be taken as medical advice. So with all of that said, Barbie, we can move on to the second slide if you don't mind. Okay, so today, we're going to be talking about insomnia and pain. And for those of us who suffer from chronic pain and chronic illness, you guys will most likely know this as painsomnia. I included this quote because I just found it to be so fitting. Considering that pain infliction and sleep deprivation are two common methods of torture, it is not difficult to imagine the misery of a person who suffers not just from chronic pain, but also insomnia. And I thought that was a really great quote to point out just how difficult one is, let alone when you're compounding them together. So what I wanted to do was, in today's discussion, basically just give you some stats and facts about insomnia and chronic pain, discuss the health risks of untreated insomnia, which were quite surprising to me, why we as chronic pain and illness sufferers are prone to insomnia, and my top 10 sleep hacks to beat painsomnia. Next slide, please. So what exactly is insomnia? I know we all have heard of it. We've probably all used the term loosely from time to time in our lives. But plainly put, insomnia is defined as habitual sleeplessness, the inability to sleep. So we know that 50 to 70 million people in the U.S. suffer from one or several sleep disorders. So you are not alone. There are plenty of us up late at night with you. Insomnia is actually a symptom. It's not really a disease. Chronic insomnia is usually tied to an underlying mental or physical issue. And what I found to be important, and what I wanted to point out here, was that insomnia has five categories, which are important so you can find an effective treatment plan. I always think that knowing what you're dealing with is better off than not. So there's a few points here. So acute insomnia is just a brief episode, difficulty sleeping. It's usually caused by a stressful life event. So something like your job or an argument with your spouse or finances, something like that, which causes you not to be able to sleep. Chronic insomnia is a long-term pattern of difficulty or sleeping. And insomnia is usually considered chronic if a person has trouble falling asleep or staying asleep at least 3 nights per week for 3 months or longer. So some people with chronic insomnia will have a long-standing history or difficulty sleeping. The next one is the one where most of us fall into. So it's called comorbid insomnia, and that occurs when it is compounded with another condition. So psychiatric symptoms such as anxiety and depression are known to change sleep patterns. And then certain medical conditions can either cause insomnia or make a person uncomfortable at night, which may make it hard to sleep. And this is, again, like I said, where we all fall in, right? Because when you're in pain, the last thing you want to do is close your eyes and start focusing on where the pain is, right? So we usually do things to avoid that. And in that whole process is where it can all start to go awry. The other two, onset insomnia, difficulty falling asleep at the beginning of the night, and maintenance insomnia is the inability to stay asleep. So what I think is interesting is that everybody agrees that insomnia is frustrating, but what most people don't realize is how dangerous it is. And this is something that I didn't even know. And it was something that affected me greatly after the fact. So long-term risks of insomnia can be things like stroke, asthma attacks, seizures, weak immune system, diabetes, obesity, high blood pressure, heart disease, sensitivity to pain, and inflammation. So when we are sleep deprived, we know that we have a heightened sensitivity to pain, which again just feeds into that whole entire cycle. You're in pain, I can't sleep, I can't sleep, you're in pain. Let's see, Barbie, the next slide I would appreciate. Okay, and so the symptoms, what I wanted to do was go over the symptoms of insomnia. Most likely, if you are attending this webinar, you know what these symptoms are. But I thought it would be good just to point it out. So some of the symptoms can be, like we said, difficulty falling asleep or staying asleep. You wake up in the morning and you're still as tired as you were when you went to bed, relying on things like sleeping pills or alcohol to fall asleep, and things like difficulty concentrating during the day. So there's a list of them right there. And, you know, most likely if you fall into a few of these, you are most likely dealing with a bout of insomnia. So next slide, please. So in this slide, what I wanted to do was start breaking everything down, right? So what is chronic pain? What is insomnia? So we know what we're dealing with. Chronic pain is defined as pain that persists past a normal healing time. So usually it is chronic if it lasts or reoccurs for more than 3 to 6 months. It's usually in the 3-month mark. Chronic pain is grouped into 4 categories, and so that can be neuropathic pain, which is when the nerves themselves are damaged. Nociceptive pain is in our nervous system, where we have receptors called nociceptors. And I'm saying that completely wrong, so excuse me for that. when you get injured, it activates these receptors. And what actually winds up happening is once they're turned on, they can't be turned off. So in many ways, they malfunction and they continue to send pain messages long after the injury has healed. And that's broken down into 2 different categories. There's visceral pain and then there is somatic pain. So this visceral pain originates from basically the major internal organs. And somatic pain is often related to joint injury, arthritic conditions, skin, ligaments, tendons, muscles, that kind of thing. Especially fibromyalgia is a big one that falls under somatic pain. Next slide. So when we are having trouble sleeping, I wanted to give you some pain and sleep facts so you wouldn't feel so alone. But compared to chronic pain patients who don't have trouble falling asleep, those who do report more severe pain, longer pain duration, and greater levels of anxiety, depression, and health anxiety, and worse impairment in physical and psychosocial functioning. So again, it's not really in your head. Sometimes we'll say to ourselves, "Ugh, why does my pain get worse at night?" And we don't really have an answer. But the truth of the matter is there is an answer. We know that with lack of sleep comes a heightened sense of pain. Sleep disturbance can be experienced in patients with chronic pain, and those can be characterized by long sleep onset, more frequent and longer awakenings after sleep onset, shorter total sleep time, lower sleep efficiency, and poor sleep quality. So in general, the community around us, approximately 20% of people living with chronic pain report at least one symptom of insomnia, compared to only 7.4% in those without chronic pain. Within the healthcare system, we know that as many 90% of the patients attending a pain management center for treatment also report at least one sleep complaint, and more than 65% of these patients would identify themselves as poor sleepers. So there's more research, and there needs to be more research that is showing that sensitivity to pain and pain conditions follows a 24-hour or a circadian rhythm. So I'm sure you've heard of circadian rhythms before, but it's basically where the whole body is set by the cycle of day and night, along with some other factors, but that's just to oversimplify it. Different pain conditions show different patterns of pain throughout the day. So this is really interesting. I know for me, when I started keeping a pain journal, I would notice these patterns throughout my day where my pain would get worse. And I always just wondered what that was. But what they really have come to find out is that, much like a circadian rhythm, our pain follows that same kind of rhythm. So morning pain can be found in people with inflammatory, this isn't the rule, right? But this is a generalization. But morning pain is found in people with inflammatory conditions, including migraines, rheumatoid arthritis, and toothaches. But people experiencing neuropathic pain can suffer from things like diabetic neuropathy or cancer. Those are more likely the ones to have pain in the evening or night. And pain at night can also disrupt sleep, which we obviously all know, and may make pain worse. So on to slide 7. Let's see here. So this is just a little bit of a continuation in terms of facts and stats, but in addition to greater pain severity and longer pain duration, pain patients with sleep disturbance also tend to report higher levels of anxiety and depression than those without any sleep issues, which we've touched upon. People reporting insomnia symptoms are at least 3 times more likely to have a chronic painful physical condition. There are several well-designed studies at this point now that have demonstrated that sleep deprivation and selective sleep disruption for no less than 3 consecutive nights can decrease pain threshold, amplify negative moods, and produce somatic symptoms mimicking those of fibromyalgia in healthy volunteers. So it doesn't take much to have some sleep deprivation to notice that your pain is increasing. I found this interesting, too, that findings from the latest studies have hinted at a possibility that, one, it's the disruption of sleep continuity rather than simple sleep deprivation that impairs pain tolerance and increases pain perception. And, two, the association between sleep and pain may be mediated by depression and or cognitive behavioral factors similar to those involved in maintenance or primary insomnia, like we discussed in the first few slides. So next slide, we're going to go on to the health risks of untreated insomnia. So when you are dealing with insomnia, it's pretty scary, and it's something that you do need to make a priority in terms of finding ways to solve it, because untreated insomnia can affect our cardiovascular system, our cognitive system, our mental and health and mood patterns, fatigue, and pain. So I just wanted to give you a few examples of what some of those might look like. But for instance, in cardiovascular problems, we see that undersleeping can also contribute to the severity of existing conditions like diabetes, heart disease, high blood pressure, stroke. And according to the National Sleep Foundation, an adult over 45 who sleeps less than 6 hours per night may have double the likelihood of stroke or heart attack when compared to someone in the same age who sleeps between 6 and 8 hours. Now, there's a lot of uproar when you actually put a number on these things, right? Because some people really only need 6 hours of sleep and they're perfectly okay. Others need closer to 8 or 9. And this is where it's really important, like when you're dealing with anything with chronic pain or chronic illness, where you need to know your body and its patterns. So It's important to understand how much sleep you need and how to get that, right? And so we'll share some of those at the end of these slides. Cognitive issues that can stem from insomnia can disrupt how the brain stores experiences and learning and short-term memory. So sometimes you'll hear people say, like, oh, I just can't remember. My brain's so foggy. That's really due to insomnia if that's something that you're grappling with. There's learning difficulties. There's difficulties reasoning and making decisions. So it really does affect the way in which you think and make, you problem solve. Mental health and mood problems. Sleep is an important part of regulating mood. So not enough sleep can trigger psychiatric illness and mood disorders or make existing conditions worse. So, for instance, insomnia and sleep deprivation has been linked to anxiety, depression, irritability, impulsive behavior, low energy, lack of motivation, and mood swings. These are all really, really hard things to be dealing with when you're already dealing with things like anxiety and depression or irritability, low energy, just from chronic pain or chronic illness itself. So you're basically just piling on top of that problem when you're also suffering with insomnia. The next system that it can really disrupt is obesity and obesity-related health problems. So we know that sleep plays a role in balancing the hunger hormones, ghrelin and leptin, and insulin. So insomniacs may find themselves overeating, choosing the wrong foods, drinking caffeinated drinks, to counteract daytime drowsiness. And what this can result in is things like excessive weight gain, joint strain and injury, low back pain, posture problems. So if you're somebody who is dealing with low back pain, for instance, and you're also dealing with insomnia and you're finding that you're putting on some pounds, it's really not going to help your low back pain in any way, shape, or form. There is also fatigue, obviously, that's a big one. So we know that it can contribute to excessive daytime sleepiness. And this gets really scary if you are driving as part of your profession or whatever it may be, picking up your kids from school or whatever it may be. You really want to make sure that you're not too overtired. And lastly, we know that pain, that sleep deprivation can lead to more pain. So often it disrupts us. It gives us fragmented sleep, and we know that it leads to more pain, which, again, creates a vicious cycle. Okay, so slide 9. Why are we, as chronic pain and chronic illness sufferers, more prone to suffering from insomnia? This is interesting because we are also prone to depression and anxiety, stress, pharmacological treatment plans, sedentary lifestyles, and co-occurring illnesses. So if we're already grappling with depression, anxiety, if we are having troubles with our finances or relationships, or we don't know where to go with our career, if we are taking medications like opiates, we know that opiates may help you fall asleep, but they don't actually help you get better sleep. In fact, opiates lower the rate of REM and slow wave sleep necessary for restful recharging sleep. Unfortunately, it just, again, keeps leading into this big cycle. So trying to find a way to stop that cycle is what we're going to do here in just a little bit. Okay, slide 10. So what contributes to insomnia? We briefly touched on it in the slide before, but basically medical illness, psychiatric illness, medication and drugs, other sleep disorders, poor sleep habits, and situational factors, right? So again, if you have a medical illness, that is definitely going to contribute. Psychiatric illnesses like bipolar disorder, dementia, schizophrenia, or PTSD can all contribute to insomnia. Medications and drugs like alcohol, narcotics, amphetamines, caffeine, even if these are things that are prescribed to you, a lot of the times you'll notice that in the insert, it'll say it may contribute to insomnia. And sometimes it says it you know, may not. But there's a list in this slide of a few of the medications that have been known to be a little bit more stimulative and keep you up at night. So let's see. Okay. So other sleep disorders can be things like sleep apnea or restless leg syndrome, poor sleep habits like stress, if you're going through grief, if you're in an unfamiliar sleep environment. These are all things that can sort of trigger it or continue it. Slide 11, please, Barbie. And I said, is it just hopeless? It certainly sounds hopeless at this point, but it's really not. I can tell you that in my 12 years of suffering with chronic pain and chronic illness, there has been definite bouts of insomnia. And what I can tell you is that the tips and tricks that I'm going to give you will work. However, you need to be 100% committed, and you need to understand that you're probably going to be doing a lot of repetitive actions over a long period of time. So in other words, you just need to stick with it, no matter how frustrating it may get or how hopeless you may feel. If you go ahead and try to implement some of the things that we're going to talk about in the next couple of slides, and you do that consistently, it'll feel like you're getting nowhere the first week or two. But eventually your body will fall in line. And that's just something that you need to just keep reminding yourself, that if you just keep doing what you need to be doing, eventually your body will give in. So next slide, please. So these are my top 10 sleep hygiene hacks. So sleep hygiene is basically just what we need to do in order to, it's basically just a variety of different practices and habits that are necessary to have good nighttime sleep quality and full daytime alertness. This actually wasn't a term that I had heard of before I went to a chronic pain recovery program back in 2013. And this was one of the cornerstones of what they taught with sleep hygiene. And so what I wound up doing was, you know, really taking what they had given me and trying to find an algorithm that worked for me. And what I have provided here today is one that works for me. It doesn't necessarily mean that's going to work for everybody, but I'm sure within this, there is something that you can pick and choose that you haven't tried. And again, remember, consistency really is the key. So the first thing that I want to talk about is following the doctor's orders. A lot of times when we are dealing with insomnia, we most likely have turned to our physicians to help us. And that visit will most likely have resulted in some kind of sleeping medication prescription. So, like most medications, our bodies are able to build up a tolerance after a consistent amount of time. The tolerance does not mean addiction. Tolerance does not mean dependence. It just basically means that it is the amount of medication that it takes for your body to achieve the same effects as it did from the starting dose, if that makes sense. So, in other words, we're basically, as time goes on, our bodies become used to it, and we need to increase the substance to maintain the same effect. And though it's natural to think, oh, you know what, I'm going to take like an extra quarter, I'm going to take like an extra half of that trazodone or that Ambien or whatever it may be, don't do it. Because first, I need you to speak to your physician, but secondly, we know that that can actually increase the severity of the insomnia. Sometimes it's just a matter of getting off of those medications and then starting all over again, but that's something that you definitely need to discuss with your physician. The second point that I wanted to make was be committed and pick a date. So insomnia is a tough cycle to break, and you're going to get a lot of pushback from both body and mind. For me, I always chose Sundays. I always thought they were, you know, starting the week. I liked, you know, that it was still on the weekend, so I wasn't in a regular routine, but whatever. Maybe your day is Tuesday or Thursday. Just pick a start date and time and be committed to it. Number three is understand your body and then listen to it. So this was a really interesting lesson for me to learn. I partied like the best of them in college. I have been married and divorced, and now that I am in my 40s, sleep, I used to be able to sleep as a sport. It's no longer the case anymore. But what I did notice is that with chronic pain, there are so many, or chronic illness, there are so many signals in our body that are firing at once. Right? Everything's really trying to get attention from us. So your pain can increase. Medication can dull certain natural responses that your body wants to have. But what I found was that at 9:45, my body gives me this fleeting moment that if I'm not really in tune with myself, I will totally miss. And if I even go to 10 o'clock, I now get a second wind. So I have learned for me, it's 9:45 or I'm up until 1 o'clock in the morning at the very least, at the very least. So this is a lot to say that it's important that at night you can kind of quiet yourself down and start to get in tune with your body. And your body may only send you like a very quick signal, a quick yawn, or it's a little too hard to get up from the couch, whatever it may be. That is your body trying to tell you that it's tired. Take advantage of that moment. Don't keep brushing it off. Okay, so next slide, Barbie. And we're going to be on the fourth one, which is stick to one bedtime every single night, even on the weekends. So we know that chronic pain and chronic illness is just exhausting, and our bodies really need sleep in order to meet the demands that chronic pain and chronic illness expect of it. Weekends don't really change that fact. So for me, I'm in bed at 9:45 on a Saturday, so pretty boring to some. But if you're trying to beat insomnia, you need to play its game a little bit, and you need to just know that once you get yourself on a schedule, then you can start, delaying that time, for whatever special occasions that you may have, a late dinner out, whatever it may be. But it is important to try to be consistent. The next rule is something that I call the 3-3 rule. So this one was a really hard for me. But 3 hours before your bedtime, start getting ready. And I know that sounds obscene, but start getting ready for bed 3 hours before, and start by stopping these three things. One, stop all snacking 3 hours before bed. Two, stop any nicotine, caffeine, or stimulant or alcohol 3 hours before bed. And lastly, and this is the toughest one, turn off all blue light screens, which means televisions, iPads, smartphones, laptops, computers, anything that will emit a screen light should be turned off 3 hours prior to bed, because the color disrupts neurochemicals, which in turn can affect your sleep-wake cycle, which again is that circadian rhythm that we were discussing. So for me, I know that this was a really, really hard thing for me to do, especially the last time I was grappling with insomnia. I was also building a business, and so my mind was always going to, I'll just work a little bit longer, or I'll just, check my email, or whatever it may be. There is a workaround. Most smartphones allow you to set your screen to a warmer yellow color at the time of your choice. And if you're on your laptop, there are actually apps that allow you to design screen color based on your circadian rhythm. So it will go ahead and dull the light and not be that bright white, which is essentially blue, but that bright screen color, because we know that your brain interprets that as it's time to get up. So if you can dull those colors, you can sort of trick your brain into being able to do both. Number six is create a routine around bedtime. So I'll give you an example of mine. I love taking baths before bed. It helps ease my chronic pain, and it just sort of relaxes me. I'll have a cup of tea. I'll read a little bit. Basically, what I'm trying to do is calm myself down, sort of wash away the stress of the day, and let go of whatever happened that day. So your bedtime routine can be anything you want it to be, as long as it doesn't include anything 3 hours before bed that that I mentioned in the above point. But whatever that looks to you, and you can get a little creative with it. You know, you can keep trying new things. You don't have to, you know, once you land on something, it doesn't necessarily have to stay that way. Number seven is no stress, which is much easier said than done, especially while we're in the midst of a pandemic. So try not to answer work emails or engage in upsetting conversations 3 hours before bed. Again, you really want to try to be creating a very relaxing environment, and engaging in stressful situations isn't going to help you at all. Something my late father always passed on to me, and something that I find very helpful, is that once you're in bed, understand that you've done all you can do for that day. You need to let it go. Tomorrow's another day with a brand new set of stressors, and you've done the best you could. And that needs to be enough for you. That is something that will take some work. but if you can manage to be able to compartmentalize your day while you're trying to unwind for your evening, really does help. All right, number eight is keep a notepad by your bedside. So I don't know if you guys or any of you are like me, but sometimes I'll wake up in the middle of the night and have a really good thought, or I'll remember that I didn't do something, or whatever it may be. What I do now is just keep a notepad and pen by my nightstand. So if I wake up, I quickly jot it down. Most times I can't even read it in the morning, so that's okay. And then it's enough for me to tell myself, you know what, it's written down, take care of it tomorrow, and I go back to sleep, as opposed to getting up and all that good stuff. Number nine is kick the clock out of your room. So this can be a little weird, but I know when I'm dealing with insomnia, I lay there looking at the clock and I'll say, if I go to bed right now, I'll get 6 hours of sleep. Or if I go to bed right now, I'll get 3 hours of sleep. And that can only keep you up more, and it really only messes with you. So what I decided to do was move my alarm clock into my master bathroom. So sounds a little weird, looks a little weird, but it works out really well, because then I don't wind up staring and focusing on the clock. Number 10 is to skip naps. So look, as chronic pain and chronic illness sufferers, this is not always something that we can avoid. Sometimes our bodies just take over and we need to lay down. Pain in all its forms is tiring, regardless of what it may be, emotional, mental, physical. So sometimes they're unavoidable, but if you can, if you absolutely need to take a nap, follow the following rules. The first one is limit your nap to an hour. Most professionals say 25 to 30 minutes is really the sweet spot, but if you need an hour, give yourself an hour. Try not to make napping a part of your daily routine. So instead, try cutting your nap time down to 2 to 3 days a week. I know for me that was a hard cycle to break, but see if you can push yourself past, because what it'll do is it'll make sure that you're tired when it's time to be tired. So with all of that said, I just wanted to say that, you know, remember that stopping bad habits is really best done by replacing them with new healthy ones. So in all of this, you need to be super patient with yourself and super patient with your illness. And with a little time and commitment, you really can overcome insomnia. And so that is what I wanted to share with you guys. I wanted to save about 15 minutes for questions and answers. And Barbie, you can tell me if anybody has something else that we haven't taken into account in terms of question and answers.
I'll remind people now, thank you so much for that presentation. You can, if you have a question, please drop it in the chat. And I did have some questions submitted prior to this in the registration, so I'm going to ask those sure. questions first before I open it up for other questions.
Yes.
So first one came from Robin, who said, sometimes I suffer with pounding with a pounding heart as I try to sleep. I start focusing on it, and then I become more anxious, and it's a vicious cycle. Any tips on how to deal with the pounding heart or anxiety?
Okay, that's a great question. So the first thing I would say to Robin is make sure that you visit your cardiologist first. You want to make sure that you're ruling out any kind of autonomic disease or cardiovascular disease. There's something that's called tachycardia, and that's when your heart starts to speed up. And so sometimes that can be a cardiovascular issue, but most times it's anxiety. So what I always say is whatever you focus on grows. Right. So if I were to say, think of a pink elephant, the only thing you can think of is a pink elephant. You're not going to be thinking of something else. So in terms of, I think Robin had it right. She starts focusing on it and then it turns into a vicious cycle. So what I would suggest is, there are tons and tons of breathing exercises that you can do. Specifically, meditation is one of them. But what I would start doing is doing it in the middle of the day, so you become used to it. So when you really need to rely on it, you have already practiced a little bit. A lot of chronic pain and chronic illness is all about finding proper coping skills. And so whether your heart is pounding or you're having a panic attack or you're just extraordinarily anxious, really learning the art of meditation can significantly help and be able to hopefully allow, to focus on something else.
Great. Thank you. The next one came from Ken. The ringing in my ears makes it hard for me to fall asleep. Could that lead to insomnia?
That's a great question. Yes. So insomnia, what we know is that it needs to go on for a period of time. If the ringing in Ken's ears is making it hard to fall asleep, what I would really suggest is before it gets to that 3-month mark, see if there is anything that can be done in terms of mitigating some of that. I don't know if it's specific to nighttime or not, but if there's something that you can work on with your physician to see if you can kind of eliminate some of that ringing, that would be hard. What you basically want to do is just make sure that you are getting sleep intermittently at the very least, right? Because we know that if it goes on consistently for 3 months, it's going to become chronic insomnia. So trying to make sure that you're getting a few nights here and there of sleep is really imperative before it actually turns into something that becomes difficult to control, if that makes sense.
Makes total sense. Thank you. Christine asks, are there any drinks, foods, spices, or vitamins that you can suggest to help me find REM sleep?
Okay, perfect. Yes, there are. There is, now again, this is sort of where I need you guys to be responsible and run everything past your physicians. But first of all, we know that what I would suggest is doing a CBC blood count with your physician and ask them to throw in panels for vitamins so you can see if you have any vitamin deficiencies. Things like magnesium are really, really important. That's a mineral, not a vitamin, but still are really important to helping you sleep. So if you're deficient in things like vitamin D, vitamin C, magnesium, those are all things that you can then start to supplement that will help. Additionally, everybody's I know who grapples with insomnia tries melatonin. Melatonin really only works if you are in bed waiting to fall asleep. So you want to make sure that you create that environment. And then lastly, along the same lines of the magnesium, there's something called CALM, C-A-L-M as in Mary, CALM. And that really is, all that really is a magnesium supplement. But they're sold in most supermarkets in the vitamin section. And you can mix it in with your drink. And what I have noticed, even if it doesn't, it relaxes my body. And so I think that might be something that you could try as well to get into REM sleep.
Awesome. Yeah, I know for me, when the doctor gives me magnesium, they also give me potassium at the same time because
something
that affects the heart. So make sure that you're not just going to the vitamin store and buying something, that you are getting the prescription that's right for you or the dose that's right for you from your provider so that you don't have any problems with that. So Holly asks, how many people with chronic pain have or develop insomnia? It seems everybody I know with pain has trouble sleeping.
Yes, that is very, very much the truth. And in the beginning of our presentation, I believe, 3 million people in the U.S. suffer from one or several sleep disorders. And then in terms of actual people with chronic pain, give me one second. I found really interesting about this statistic was there were so many of us who have been suffering. Here we go. 20% of people living with chronic pain report at least one symptom of insomnia compared to only 7.4 for those people who don't have chronic pain. So we are definitely in the higher percentage. And again, that's just because,
It seems so much higher than that, but when you compare it to
it does.
The norm is 7%, 20 is still quite a difference than 7%, but it seems it seems so common. So thank you, Holly, for
it
your
does. It does.
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, that was a great question, Holly. No, that was great. Thank you.
If I got rid of my chronic pain, would I still have insomnia?
A great question. So a couple of things here. First of all, getting rid of chronic pain, I think, is a perspective that is always good to adjust. The truth of the matter is our bodies and our brains become so used to pain that in a very, very, very simplistic form, it almost starts creating chronic pain because that's what it thinks is normal. And again, that's a very, very simplistic form. So chronic pain, unfortunately, there is no cure. It can be improved upon, but the fact that for most of us, chronic pain will never necessarily go away. So that's the first thing. The second thing is that, yes, if in a perfect world you were able to get rid of your chronic pain, if you have passed that 3-month mark, that 3 to 6 month mark, now your insomnia is chronic. And like all chronic things, it is difficult to break that cycle. The good news is that there are sleep aids. There are minor adjustments that you can do that you can break that insomnia pattern. But it wouldn't, in other words, if you just woke up tomorrow without any pain, you wouldn't be able to sleep that following night because it really is all about modifying your behavior. Sorry about that, my dogs.
No problem. I didn't know if that was your line or somebody else's. Okay, so the tired and fatigued.
What's the difference between tired and fatigued? That's a good question. So when you're tired, it literally is. It is your body's way of saying that it needs to recharge, that it absolutely needs the sleep that, you need to be getting. So cells can rebuild, muscles can be rebuilt, all of that good stuff. Tired is when your body has basically had enough. Fatigued is a little bit different, right? You're lazy, it's almost harder to move your body. We know that there is something called chronic fatigue syndrome, and that's where you're basically always, your body always feels, the best way I describe it is walking through quicksand. So every move that you make is an effort.
Do you recommend a certain room temperature for sleeping?
That's a great question. So what we know is that our bodies actually drop about, I believe it's 2 degrees, when we are sleeping. And so again, that goes into the circadian rhythm that we were discussing. And so what they have found, what researchers have found, is that if your body overheats too much, that instantaneously, that'll wake you up. So you want to keep your bedroom somewhat cool, where you can, you know, nothing cold, but somewhat cool. And so where you need a little bit of covers. And so that will adjust to your body temperature also dropping, your heart rate dropping, your respiratory system slowing down a little bit. That'll just feed all of those bodily automatic things that are taking place as you're trying to wind down.
Great. Now here's off the blue screens. With Ken, he has to have like some kind of background noise versus to drown out the tinnitus sound.
Okay.
While he sleeps, or it wakes him up. Yeah, to fall asleep, to get past the noise.
Fall asleep. Okay.
Right. So do you think that it's better to have some kind of background noise, even if it's like, if it's not a TV screen?
Yeah,
it's better to have nothing.
Well, you know what? Look, I will always say this. Nobody knows our bodies better than us. Physicians can tell us till they're blue in the face that something's not happening in our bodies when it is, and it's like, you know, like, who are you going to believe here? Like, I'm living in this body. So these are loose guidelines. These are ones that work for me. If Ken, it's easier for you, if it's better for you, have noise in the background, go for it. What you may want to try is seeing if you can put it on some sort of timer. So for instance, do you need that noise even if you start to wake up and you're in a lighter sleep for you to fall back asleep? Or once you're asleep, perhaps you don't need the noise throughout the rest of the night. Those are kind of little experiments that I think would be helpful to try. You know, but again, if it's what works for you to get you asleep, I say do it, and just see if you can modify it a little bit.
Thank you. And
sure. I don't know if that helped.
I don't know either, but hopefully it did. my last question is, if you have chronic pain, then you have trouble sleeping, and you get the pain under control, your sleeping should improve. But if it doesn't, what are some of the things? I mean, I know we talked a little bit about getting the right bedtime and lowering distractions, but is there anything else that a person can do? Do you think they need to see a neurologist or an epileptologist, or like, what's their next step?
That's a great question. So ideally what you want to do is, before you start implementing any of these, I think it's important to rule out that it's not something else, right? Pain affecting sleep is awful. But what you want to make sure is that it's not something else that's physically going on. So what I always like to do is start ruling things out. So doing something like a sleep study might be actually really effective, right? Because they'll be able to measure your brain waves, how much REM sleep you're getting, how much light sleep you're getting. And so they'll be able to rule out if there's any other problem. So start there. I think that speaking to your physician, and look, I think that so many of us hear each other say, oh, I don't sleep. I know, I don't sleep either. I get like 3 hours of sleep, and then I'm like, you know, we're all very used to that conversation. So it sort of has normalized insomnia. And it's really something that is pretty dangerous to have to continue on. So what I would say is, again, first, speak to your doctor openly, honestly. If you're taking, you know, more medication just to go to bed, tell them that. It's important for them to know that. And then once you sort of map out a plan with your physician, you can start implementing these things one at a time. And the reason why I say one at a time is because it may not take all 10 of them. It may only take 4 of them. But you want to be able to start hypothesizing what the issue is, and then knowing one by one what's working, what's not working, if that makes sense.
Yeah, Yeah, and make sure you take notes on what helped and what didn't help, so when you go talk to the doctor, you have a better conversation.
Correct. That's a huge point.
For patients that have done the sleep study and they didn't find anything wrong with their sleeping, the patient's just having trouble sleeping, what would their next step be? Where would they go next?
So their next step, so what I would really suggest, so there's a few things, right? And again, we've all been told these things, but I think what makes the difference here is that, you know, we hear all the time, oh, try acupuncture, it worked for me, or, you know, try X, Y, and Z, it worked for me. So we start to hear all of these suggestions and opinions, and what winds up happening is we'll say, oh, yeah, I tried acupuncture, I went twice, you know, it didn't work for me. That's not really giving it a full go, right? So what you really want to do is whatever you're choosing to implement, you really want to see it through so you know. I'll actually make this point as well, too. In the beginning of my plight with chronic pain, I specifically deal with pelvic pain. I tried castor oil. So you take like a wool cloth, you put castor oil on it, you could put it, you know, on whatever part of your body that hurts, with a heating pad, whatever. I tried it in the very beginning of my illness, and it was like nothing. Like, I did absolutely nothing. Fast forward 12 years later, and my mother actually says to me, oh, I bought you castor oil. Have you ever tried it? I'm like, oh, I tried it. It doesn't work. Forget it. Whatever. I was so desperate one night that I decided to grab the castor oil, and I put it on, and it really, really helped. So I bring up that story just to say that what you may have settled on that didn't work years ago may actually work now. So you really don't want to rule things out. You want to make sure that you're giving it a fair try. And again, I would really start with doing things like the getting a CBC and understanding if you have any deficiencies in vitamins or minerals. I would speak to a nutritionist, and because there are certain foods that you can avoid that, you know, perpetuate pain, right? An anti-inflammatory diet is absolutely going to help with pain. And so, you know, starting there might be an option. So it really depends on what you're grappling with and where you are in your plight with chronic pain. But what I always say is start first with your doctors, and then you can start working out to do more of like the non-pharmacologic modalities. Everybody learned a little something and got something to take away with. I have included my contact information, which is on, I think, the second or last slide. And there are references at the bottom, the last two slides of these. So if anybody wants to go back, they're more than welcome to look up the references that I used.
Great. Thank you so much for being here. I really appreciate it. I think
that
this will be helpful information for all the attendees and everybody listening back in replay mode, and I appreciate your time, not just with this webinar, but all the other ways that you are partnering with International Pain Foundation and working with our network of patients and caregivers. So thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Barbie. I really appreciate it. I enjoy working with you guys.